Okay, today we will continue discussing the steady current and current density. So if you remember, the last thing we talked about last time was the postulates of a steady current. So divergence of J equals zero and curl of J over sigma equals zero, and we essentially got to those postulates from considering the postulates of electrostatics and cross E equal zero, right? And so essentially we derived them from electrostatics. The only reason we call those postulates is to keep things clean, right? Because we said by definition, those electrostatic equations assume no movement of charge, while in this very special case where we have a steady movement of charge, which is a steady current, the postulates still apply, and we can derive those two results, right? But to keep things separate and clean, to keep the domain of the things that are moving, domain of the things that are not moving separate, we, after we derive those, we introduce them as postulates, although we derive them. Okay, it's just a matter of language. I mean the results are the results, right? Which brings up a correction that we need to make. So we introduce those two as postulates, but there's an issue here though. What is the issue? The issue is that this assumes that in space, you would get, let's say you have a field flowing, not a field, sorry, a current flowing. So we said because the divergence is zero, it has no point source, the current is always, the charges are always flowing in a closed circuit, right? But then we said that there is energy being lost, right? So there is... So what happens in situations there is an infinite conductivity, that's fine, the current's going to keep moving. But if the conductivity is low, right, there are losses. So this is the loss density, J dot E, watts per meter cubed. So energy is being lost due to the movement of that current, right? Because energy is being lost, that current cannot be sustained, right? So eventually the charges should stop. So you would think that this would need correction, and this thing needs correction actually. And when we figure out how to correct it, that leads us to Kirchhoff's voltage law, which is the correct second steady current, right? So this forces us to discuss the idea of the source of a steady current, right? How can you get the only way to get steady current moving forever is to have the current moving in a loop where the conductivity is infinite. By the way, the curious thing is there is a special kind of material that exists in nature actually with an infinite conductivity. And by infinite, I mean really infinite. Like, it's not an approximation. It does not approach infinity. It is really infinite. The converse is that R, the resistivity, is zero for that material, right? And this kind of material is called a superconductor. So yeah, that's one of the amazing things that you would think would not exist in nature. You know, you would think that, hey, maybe there's are incredibly good conductors, but not a superconductor, but there are. Superconductors are precisely R equals zero. It's not R equals 0.00001 ohms. No, it is, they have precisely zero ohms of resistance. They are completely lossless, right? But then, I mean, you only get them if you are at very cold temperatures, extremely cold, and at higher temperatures, you need to apply much higher pressure to get them. Okay? But for most other materials, even the best conductors, those materials will be lossy. So we need to figure out a way to have a source for the current source, like a battery or something. Right? So think of a capacitor. Capacitor could be a source for current, right? So if you have a capacitor, it will discharge. But the voltage across the capacitor is going to dwindle, right? And it's going to stop discharging. What if I keep pushing charge into the capacitor so that its voltage is constant, right? And then I have a steady current. So this gives me what was called a battery. Right? And there are many other ways to keep supplying this charge that causes a steady current and that counteracts the losses in the medium. Because that's the only reason we have to keep pushing the charge around, because it is the resistivity of the material that stops the charge from just continuously moving forever. Unless it's a semiconductor. So this kind of thing that in a loop, let's say, this kind of thing that moves the charges around. So there is energy lost in the material, J dot E. The thing that we connect to the loop that causes that substitutes this lost energy. And causes the steady current to be maintained is called the electromotive force. And it is typically defined as a voltage, So when I write this postulate that J over epsilon, this is E dot dl, it's not actually equal to zero. Let's call this VB for V battery. Right? It's not actually equal to zero, it's equal to the voltage that is generated by the battery, which keeps the current moving. It's equal to the electromotive force. And this is essentially Kirchhoff's law, right? This is Kirchhoff's law. It's saying all the, so this is J over sigma, which is E, right? This is E. What is E dot dl? E dot dl is voltage drop, right? E dot dl is voltage drop across a small element, right? This is dl. This is dl. It's a voltage drop across the small element in the loop of the current, right? And the sum of all those voltage drops, right? Is equal to the electromotive force by the battery. This is Kirchhoff's law. So this is actually the second postulate. Okay. So that's that. You have to be mindful that the current is not gonna, even if a steady current exists, it will not maintain itself for a long time unless there is an electromotive force. Okay, so now I'm gonna move to discussing the interface conditions of current density. Okay, and it's a problem that's similar to the problem that we analyzed when we talked about dielectric, we discussed dielectric materials, right? We could have an interface with two materials, material one, material two, and each material will have a different conductivity. So I have sigma one and sigma two, So what is, how can, same deal, I mean, we have J2, right? And here, just before the interface, and J1, just after the interface, and we can divide. Let me draw it closer to the interface. Right, so this is J2. So I can draw a component that's tangent, J2 tangent, and here, let me draw it closer to. And this is J1. Also, it has the tangent component, J1 tangent. And we know from electrostatics that E1t equals E2t. This result should still be valid, but we know how to relate J to E, right? J is sigma E. So that tells me that J1t over sigma 1 equals J2t over sigma 2. So there is a discontinuity in the normal component of J, sorry, in the tangent component of say J due to variation in sigma. Right. What about right? So that's the tangent component. Now to find the normal the transition across the interface of the normal component, we use the first postulate, right? Remember the first postulate of steady current, which is divergence of J equals zero. So this is similar to the divergence of Gauss's law for the electrostatic field. Right, so we have to, I'm going to use, of course, the integral version of this, which is integral over a closed surface of J dot ds equals zero. So I'm going to take a small volume across the interface, take a cylinder like this. Let me draw this clearly. Oh. So this is the interface. And again, the normal component, I'm gonna assume also like a positive direction for the normal component. Typically, we make it positive in medium one. So this is n hat. Right, and then yeah, so this is area S, the side area of the small cylinder will not factor in because J is going to be 90 degrees with respect to the vector representing that area, so the dot product will be zero in the integral, right? So so yeah, so it's going to be J1. So J1 in S, right? Right. So this is in this surface, right? And then on this surface, so I'm gonna add the next one for this surface. Now the normal vector to the surface is minus n hat, right? You see that because the surface is pointing outwards. Remember, we always assume the positive, the vector that represents the surface, as you assume it to point outwards from the volume enclosed by the surface. So this is going to be plus minus J1, J2 NS equals zero. Right, S goes away with S, and then you end up with J1N equals J2N. And this completes the interface condition. We figured out what happens to the tangential component of the steady current and the density and the normal components of the steady current density. So, of the current density in general. Right, so this is G1T over sigma 1 equals J2T over sigma 2, right? And then J1N equals J2N. So those are the interface conditions, right? What about the existence of any charge density? How can we determine if any charge density rho s is gonna exist on the interface? Is there a way to determine that? Okay. So what's J1? What's remember what we said? We said we determined that by let me try to remember. Oh yeah, D1s minus D2, sorry, D1n minus D2n equals rho s, right? So the difference in the normal component of the flux density is what determines the existence of any charge density, right? But what is D? D is epsilon, right? So epsilon 1 E1n minus epsilon 2 E2n equals rho of s, right? We know how to relate E to J, right? E is J over sigma. So you end up with epsilon 1 over sigma 1 J1n minus epsilon 2 over sigma 2 G2n equals rho of s. Okay, so this gives me the equation that tells me if there is, depending on what J1n and G2n is, right? Of course, we know that they are equal, right? So let me call J1, let me say J1n equals J2n equals Jn, right? We established that J1n equals J2n. Those are the interface conditions. I'm not going to change that. I'm just going to try to derive an equation that determines what any charge density on the surface, on the interface, would be if it exists. Okay, so J1n equals J2n equals Jn. So that tells me that rho of s equals Jn times epsilon 1 over sigma 1 minus epsilon 2 over sigma 2. So, and this is an interesting result. It shows that the charge density on the interface, if there is a normal current flowing, is going to depend on the difference between the ratios of sigma 1 over epsilon 1 over sigma 1 and epsilon 2 over sigma 2. If epsilon 1 over sigma 1 equals epsilon 2 over sigma 2, even though the epsilons or the sigmas might be different, then there will be no charge density. If the ratio difference between the ratios is not equal, then there will be some charge density. Okay, so this is an interesting relation that tells you in situations where current is flowing, whether a surface charge density would appear at the interface. Okay. By the way, this is true even if a charge density appears, right? Why is this true even if charge density appears? Because this follows from this postulate, which is always true. This is always true. Current cannot be, there is no source for current, right? At steady state, of course, if we are, if things are varying, right, then we know from the continuity equation, divergence of B is equals minus d rho v over dt. So this is the non-steady state situation, right? Non-steady state. But at steady state, where everything settled, this is true. Therefore, those conditions are true. And remember, we're still discussing steady state current. That's steady and it's not changing in time. Once we still haven't talked really or introduced time varying currents or fields. All right, so this concludes this chapter about this discussion about steady state currents, steady state current density. Right, so those are we're just introducing steady state current as a source. As I said in the beginning, source of what? Source of the magnetostatic field, which is what we will be discussing next. Magnetostatic field. Okay. So what is the magnetic field? The magnetic field is the other type of force field in electromagnetics. There are two force fields in electromagnetics. There's the electrical force field and the magnetic force field. So historically, the electric force field arised from the study of charged objects, right? Nobody knew about the electron historically, but people, or the proton, or any of the constituents of matter, but they knew that objects could get electrified, right? And electrified objects attract each other. For example, if you have glass or rubber, right? So we know that story at the beginning, right? What about magnetism? Well, magnetism arised also from ores, special kinds of ores that people could, magnetic ores that people could mine and or find lying around, you know, on the ground. And those special ores attracted each other. So if you have two ores of the same kind, they would attract each other. Sometimes they would repel each other. And eventually people discovered that if you build a compass, a needle, from such an ore, right, from such a lodestone metal, it has this unique property where it aligns itself to the North Pole. So that's why they called like the two kinds of magnetic sources as North Pole and South Pole, right? So people quickly noticed that, hey, I mean, this aligns itself to the North Pole. Perhaps the whole Earth itself is a magnet, right? So, before any conception of the electric field, we had awareness that magnets exist, and we could mine them, and we could use them to build compasses and so on and so forth. And they seem to be, you know, their own separate domain, right? If I get a glass and I charged it with an electrical charge, it does not get attracted in any way or repulsed in any way to a magnet, with respect to a magnet. So for the longest time, seemingly it looked like that magnetic phenomena and electric phenomena were two separate things, two separate aspects of nature that are not related to each other, right? And both are both were not very well understood, right? I mean, one contrasting thing, one, I mean, even if you didn't know that there was a relationship between them, one, and you wanted to contrast them, one big contrast is that you could, you know, divide charged objects into parts that are positively charged and parts that are negatively charged, right? But you'd never seem to be able to divide a magnetic object into a pure north. There was no magnetic object that was purely north, right? And no magnetic object that was purely south. All magnetic objects seem to have some combination of north and south. They seem to have kind of like the Earth. This is the Earth. They seem to have poles. So this is the Earth. Those are the longitude lines, right? And there's always some North Pole and then some South Pole, and then the North Poles repel each other, South Poles repel each other, North South attract each other, So people understood that much about magnets, right? And in previous lecture, I was talking a lot about how we are studying current and studying current as being the source or a source of the magnetic field, right? So that is more of a recent understanding, right? It took until around the 1800s, guy called Oersted, Hans Christian Oersted, to notice something peculiar. At that time, as the study of electricity evolved, people started to understand electricity slowly better. They started to understand the existence of positive and negative charges. That was the main contribution of Benjamin Franklin. But then experimentally, people started to experiment with electricity a lot more. And the technology that allowed that to happen is the Volta pile. So there's a guy called Volta, Italian. He discovered that if you take a bunch of metallic discs and you stack them on top of each other with so those are metallic discs, two different kinds of metals, like either copper and silver, for example, and between them you have paper with brine, soaked in brine. So this turns out to be the dielectric. People didn't understand that at the time, but what they understood is that you get electricity out of this pile, right? And why did they know that they got electricity? Because, well, I mean, if you have positively charged objects, it's attracted to that. But furthermore, if you take this pile, if you take one funny story is that I'm not sure how true it is, but I've read it somewhere that people started to understand that if you take this pile, this very primitive battery, this voltaic pile, and you short it like that, you get a current flowing, right, through the circuit. So there will be some resistance. People didn't understand that at the time, but what will happen is that you will get a current. How one of the earliest ways that people understood that there is a current passing here in the circuit, if you connect a conductor to the positive and negative ports of the pile, is some people took the two ends of the conductor before they shorted together, and they stuck it in their tongue, and they could feel something. What they could feel was the electrical current flowing, right? So that's one origin story for the understanding that emerged, that there's a current flowing in a closed circuit. The other thing that happened is that people started playing, with that thing, with this pile. So they started, stacking more and more discs together until they got higher and higher and higher voltages. And they started connecting them in series and in parallel, and stacking them until they got a really high voltage, until they got to a point, even though you have the two copper wires, even though they are not touching, the voltage got too high from their experimentation that a spark started to, an arc started to develop. And this is one of people would do lectures where they would demonstrate those arcs that are jumping from one side of the copper to the other copper wire, right? And this is some other way where people started to visualize the current that's happening in the loop, right? So although we couldn't see current, we could see those effects. We could see the arc going through the conductor wires. Clearly something is flowing. You feel something if you touch it, sometimes you see a spark. The metal itself heats, which gives you an indication, hey, something is moving, something is happening in the wire. Why is the wire heating up? Yeah, so people quickly understood that there's a current that's happening. Right? And they interpret it correctly as the movement of charge, which they understood. They didn't know about the electron and the proton and all of that. They understood charge to be some fluid that exists in the material. Okay. Now the interesting experiment happened. So those two things existed, and then this guy Oersted was lucky enough to run an experiment with a current. So he had a voltaic pile, and he had a current flowing in some circuit. And the circuit has some resistance, whatever. And then he had lying in his bench or in his lab some compass lying somewhere north south. He noticed that when he energized the circuit, so he had like a switch and he let current flow, the compass moved, right? So the compass moved to align itself with the current flowing. And if you change the direction of the current, the alignment of the compass flipped. This was a clear indication that somehow this magnetic field that you got from magnets, things that you mine from the ground, is intimately related to current. So this current flowing through the circuit must be generating its own magnetic field that's interacting with the magnet of the compass. Right. So current needs to be, must be a source of the magnetic fields. And this was kind of like the first hint of the unification between the both of those fields. It's not, that's why the field is called electromagnetics. Right? But it's not a complete unification yet. Why? Because we started with an electrostatic field. Electrostatic field in some materials leads to current flowing, J, let's say, or I, if it's current flowing through a very thin wire. This current flowing leads to the magnetic field, let's say, north-south. So this is B, right? So we can go from electrostatic field to magnetic field. But we cannot go in the opposite direction. I cannot show that from a magnetic field, static magnetic field, I can get a static. This is static. This is static, not time varying. So I can show that from a static electric field, I can generate a current, and I can generate a static magnetic field. So in this way, I tied electricity with magnetism. But still, they couldn't show yet that starting with a magnetic field, you can get an electric field that's, static. To gain this full connection in both directions, we have to study time varying. So a time varying electric field generates a magnetic, time varying magnetic field. And then a time varying magnetic field generates an electric field. Only when we switch to time varying fields, do we get the full unified picture? Okay, so we're not there yet, right. So we'll discuss that later, right? So people began to understand that currents generate the magnetic field. Right, and then people like Biot, Savart, I think it's an R. Yeah. So that's what led to Biot, Savart, Law. Right, Biot and Savart are two different scientists, and then Ampère, a big figure. Right, studied the magnetic field force more, and we arrived at the Ampere law, which is in many ways equivalent to Gauss's law, only it has to do with the curl. Right, so Ampere, Biot, Savart are more, especially Ampere, they are big figures. right? And yeah, so Bios Abbas especially discovered that there are forces between two wires carrying currents, right? And right, and they use that understanding to understand how moving electrical charges are affected by the magnetic field. Okay, so the idea is that, like we said, a current produces a magnetic field, right? But how do we detect the magnetic field? Ultimately, I mean, the magnetic field is a force field, remember? I mean, for it to have any physical meaning, it has to act with some force on something, some object, right? And that object, the only objects that we know that could interact with fields are the electrical charges, right? Charges, Q, which could be positive, could be negative. Those are the only objects that could interact with fields, right? Electrical or magnetic. Right? But we know that, hey, if I get a test charge in point in space, right, the force is going to be QE, right? So the electrostatic field covers the force that the charge feels if it's stationary, right? So the leap here comes from understanding that if a current generates a magnetic field, right, and it interacts with a magnetic object, right, it interacts with another current. So I have a current that generates a magnetic field. I have another current, so two wires, let's say, that generates another magnetic field, and they interact with a force between them. What's happening here? That means that this magnetic field from the first wire is reaching. This is an empirical result. This is what Pio Sabah experimentally deduced, right? It's not theoretical up to this point. Those are all experiments done in labs with wires and batteries and currents and, you know, ways to measure the force and whatnot. Right? So one wire generates a magnetic field, which interacts with the other wire, causing a force to appear on the wire. All right, so that's fine. You can understand the force between two wires, but what is a wire with a current passing in it really? Really, what is it? It is a bunch of charges. So there are in the wire. If I zoom in into the wire, there's a bunch of charges that are moving, right? So it seems that the key thing to generate a magnetic force, right? If I have a wire with a current and a wire with no current, there is no force. People discover there is no force. So it turns out the key thing for the magnetic field to generate a force on a particle that's charged is that this particle needs to be moving. There has to be a velocity. Right, if a particle exists, charged particle exists in a magnetic field, and this particle is not moving, this particle will not feel any force. Only if it moves will it feel in some force, and that force will depend on the direction of the movement of the particle and its velocity. Right, and from all those empirical experiments, the law that can be distilled is this. The magnetic force relates to the magnetic field as follows. The force equals Q, the value of the charge, V, the velocity of that charge, cross B. Right? So this is called the Lorentz force equation. Right? And it could be used as the definition of the magnetic field. V, by the way, turns out to be the magnetic flux density. I'll talk about, I mean, similar to having E and D for electricity, electrostatics, where we have the field, electric field intensity and the electric flux density. For magnetostatics, also we can describe the field in two ways. We can describe it with the magnetic field intensity, right, intensity, and the magnetic flux density in an analog manner, right? And I'll go deeper into those two different representations of the magnetic field. But suffice to say, kind of like E is dependent let's see. Right? Yeah, I'll discuss that later. Okay, so that's the Lorentz force equation, which describes how charges interact with a magnetic field. Of course, the full force equation, which is called the Lorentz Coulomb force equation, is the sum. So this is QE, this is the electrostatic force, plus QV times B, cross B, okay? Now, when using the cross product, this encodes the force with the right-hand side property, right? So if I have a particle, a charged particle moving in this direction, V, and then the magnetic field is in this direction, B, because we're doing a cross product, right, V cross B, the force is going to be pointing, so you do the right hand rule, you have your thumb pointing, you have your, let's see, let me draw your hand, so not a very good, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, humans have 5 fingers, I think, right? Anyway, right. So your. Let me draw the thumb. Oh, that's better than I expected. Right. So the thumb points towards the velocity. The fingers point towards the magnetic field, and then the palm of your hand. This is the palm of your hand. Points to where the force is pointing. So the force is pointing upwards. Fm. This is called the right-hand rule, and it's encoded in the cross product. We studied it when we discussed the definition of the cross product. So we don't have to think about it much, it's encoded in the cross product. Okay. All right. So that's interesting. That provides us, this empirical results, provides us with a way to measure, to define the magnetostatic field, right? The flux density, at least. So remember when we said FE equals QE, so we can define E as limit as QT approaches zero of F, the force that the particle feels due to electrostatics over QT. Same way, we can define, it's a little bit more complicated though because of the cross product, right? But what we can do is, hey, if there's a, how do I define, right, so let's say there's a certain B, magnetic field, okay? How do I define this magnetic field using Lorentz force equation? Well, I can say if this thing moves a short distance in a certain speed, it will feel a force, right? So that, but then there are an infinite amount of directions it could go, right? So we keep sweeping all the directions until we reach the direction of maximum force. What is the direction of maximum force? It's this direction, this and it's this direction, and in this at this direction. The two directions that are, well, there are multiple of them. There are directions in a disk that's perpendicular to B. Okay, and any of those directions which are 90 degrees from B, we will get the maximum force. So if we do this experiment, imagine we put a test charge. We find this disk, right? So we have a test charge. And then we discover, hey, I'm moving it in any direction, but then there's a disk around a surface disk around this point, such that if I move in any direction in the disk, I get a force, the same force, and that will be the maximum force I can get. If the disk is oriented differently, I'll get a smaller force, right? So if I discover that experimentally, that tells me, hey, there's a magnetic field that's normal to that disk, and its magnitude is going to be the magnitude of that force that I'm calculating, divided by Q, divided by V, right? So it's more complicated than the electrostatic field, because it's not just the particle sitting there and feeling a force. You have to experiment with it. You have to move it in different surfaces until you find the surface that gives you the maximum force, right? So, and you divide the force by the charge and the velocity to get the magnetostatic field. As you can see, this is not a very good way to do it empirically, but this is a good way to define the field, right? And let's see, the units for B are naturally, so it's force over charge and velocity. So the units of B are Newton over Coulomb, right? So this is the force and the velocity, and the force and the charge, and then the velocity is meter over second, right? So so this is, let me take the Coulomb downstairs. So this becomes Newton over meter times Coulomb per second. What's Coulomb per second? It's amps, right? So it's Newton over amp dot meter. This unit is called the Tesla. And this is the SI unit for the magnetic flux density field. Another very popular unit, and which we will use a lot, you have to know how to use them interchangeably, is Weber. Per meter squared. Right? Although T is the Tesla, is the SI unit, Weber per meter squared is still very useful, and you need to know it. Notice how the similar form it has to the electric flux density. Electric flux density has units of Coulomb per meter squared. Magnetic flux density, the field, has units of Weber over meter squared. This instantly should give you a hint on what the Weber is. Right. Notice Coulomb is the unit of charge for electrical charges. So this should, if you compare this with this, this should instantly tell you that Weber is the unit of charge for magnetic charges. Remember, we said in a previous lecture. Lecture that theoretically you could imagine that magnetic charges exist, although they don't mathematically. You imagine that they exist mathematically, and they are very useful to imagine that they exist mathematically. So in another universe, maybe you could have had magnetic charges that generate magnetic fields, and you have magnetic Coulomb law where different magnetic charges attract, right? So in a different universe, maybe those magnetic charges would have existed, but even though they don't exist in this universe, it's still useful theoretically to assume that they exist, at least mathematically. So with that understanding, the Weber, if you compare B with D, Coulomb over meter square, Weber over meter square, clearly the Weber is the unit of the magnetic charge. Okay, and in a similar manner, where we say D equals epsilon E right, where we and epsilon depends on the material permittivity, right, and that ties the force field, electric field intensity, with the electric flux density. In a similar manner, there's a relationship that between B, the flux density, and H, the field intensity for the magnetic field. And there's a constant between them that depends on the material, and this is called the magnetic permeability. And it is also very analogous to electrostatics. We will discuss that in more detail when we talk about magnetic materials, but suffice to say, similar, where we have here, this thing has units of farad per meter, right? E has units of volt per meter, D has units of coulomb per meter squared, B has units of Weber per meter squared. Notice electric charge, magnetic charge per meter squared. H, here we have volt per meter, H is going to be amp per meter. H is the force field, it does not depend on the material, while B depends on the material. Right? And mu, what's the unit of the permeability? Well, I mean it's let's divide the two units. So it's Weber over meter squared divided by amp over meter, which is meter over amp, right? Which is 1 over meter. I cancel the meter, and then it's Weber over amp. Right, so I cancel the meter, I have 1 meter, and then I have Weber over amp. So similar when for the case of epsilon, where I get coulomb over volt, right, which is capacitance, farad over, I end up farad over meter, this tends to kind of show me some kind of capacity, the relationship between the current and the amount of magnetic charge, right? This is called, we will discuss that in detail later when we discuss inductance, but this unit is called Henry. It's familiar to you from circuits. It's the unit of the inductance. And inductance is the capacity unit for magnetics, similar to the capacitance, the farad being the capacity unit for electrostatics. So the units of mu, the permeability, are Henry per meter. Of course, if we are dealing with air, B is going to equal mu naught H, right? Where mu naught is by definition equal to 4 pi times 10 to the power minus 7 Henry per meter. This is, by the way, not empirical. This is, we chose that value for certain historical reasons, right? Because it turned out in theory what matters is not the value of epsilon and mu. What matters really is the product of epsilon and mu. That's the constant, which turns out to be related to the speed of light. Okay, this is what matters. So that's why typically in the treatment of the theory, they tell you, hey, we're going to define mu naught to be this, and then epsilon naught will be dependent on this definition. Okay, and magnetostatics, remember in electrostatics, it was D that did not depend on the material, while E depended on the material. In magnetostatics, B tends to depend on the material, while H does not depend on the material. We will discuss that further when we again discuss materials. But for this chapter, for this introduction into magnetostatics, whenever we are calculating the static magnetic field, we're going to start with H, right? And then from H we can get B. We want to get to B ultimately because the force equation uses B. The force equation uses B. All right, the Lorentz force equation. But to calculate the field, it's more convenient to start with H. Okay, and historically, two ways were developed to calculate the magnetostatic field. The first way is the Biot-Savart law, and the second way is the famous Ampere's law. Okay, and we will continue this in the next lecture.